So let's think a little bit about safety of conversion. This is similar to the question that we asked about converting between various signed and unsigned integer formats. So take a second, pause the video, and think about each of these conversions and see if you can make a guess as to which of these are safe. And in other words, where can the value always be preserved? Okay, so let's think about these. So converting from a 32-bit integer to a 32-bit floating point number. So the insight here is that in going from an integer to a floating point number, we've lost some of the bits that we can use for the significand. So the integer part is going to have to be stored in the significand, right? And so by taking away even one bit each for the sign bit and for, well, especially for the significand bit, I guess we already had lost the sign bit to being a signed integer, but losing even a single bit to the exponent drops the number of numbers that we can represent exactly. And so we may have to round the number when we convert it from an integer to a similarly sized floating point number. It turns out that B is actually safe, and if you were wrong on this one, that's fine. The intuition is okay. It turns out that with a 64-bit floating point number, you actually have more than 32 bits for the significand, and so you can actually store all 32-bit numbers in the 64-bit significand field. And so that's actually safe, even though it may be a little counterintuitive. So let's think about converting from a floating point to an integer. Hopefully, it's relatively intuitive that this is going to potentially cause rounding error no matter what you do, right? Because if you have a number that is a fraction, then you can't represent it using an integer format. So both C and D are hopefully fairly obviously going to result in some rounding or potentially overflow, right? If the value is too large to be represented in the integer format. And then converting from a 32-bit floating point number to a 64-bit, hopefully, if you think about it a little bit, you should be able to convince yourself that that's okay. Anything that can be represented in a smaller can be represented in the larger simply by zero extending the significand on the right and then re-encoding the exponent. The converse is not true, obviously. The converting from a larger number, larger floating point number to a smaller floating point number is not always going to be safe because for, you know, approximately half, you know, for a lot of those numbers, you're going to have to round it off. So here's a table that summarizes this. So converting from the column on the left to the row on the right, a dash indicates that the conversion is safe, and O indicates that it could overflow, and an R indicates that rounding is, or an R indicates that rounding is possible. The book also talks a little bit about different rounding modes. We're not going to put much emphasis on this, but I did want you to at least see that there are different rounding modes in floating point arithmetic. It turns out somewhat counterintuitively that the one that we use most often is something called round to even, which rounds to the nearest, and on ties it favors even numbers. And this is done to avoid some statistical biases. And again, the details aren't terribly important, we think, for this course, but the details are in the book if you're interested in why that's the case.